flat. Huh? A flat.
Stay flat.
So everybody take your songbooks, we're going to turn to page 165. Page 165. Brother Terry, if you'll lead us in prayer.
Heavenly Father, Lord, we thank you for this evening. You bless us with the Lord. We're thankful and grateful, Heavenly Father, for the service that we had this morning and the afternoon that you bless us with, Lord. Lord, we pray for Brother Larry, why he's away from us, Heavenly Father, and Brother Tony as he stands tonight, Lord, that he would give us just exactly what you would have us to have this evening, Lord. Pray for this offering as we take it up, Lord, that it could be used to build thy kingdom. In Jesus' name we pray.
Second verse. Kneel at the cross. Does anyone have a prayer request this evening? I desire your prayers. And just remember, Carly is, we'll be traveling. We'll be going down Thursday. And I'll just pray that the weather's will be good. And I don't stay down there with her. That I'll come back home. But I just desire your prayers. Anyone else?
Just continue to remember Francis.
Oh.
Brother, I got a niece in South Alabama, her stepson. 2 years ago, when he was 6 years old, you may have seen it on the news, it was on national news, he got bit by a shark and off the coast of Florida. And just this past week or so, he's been diagnosed with Lyme disease. Keep him in prayer.
Just remember this. Let's move over to the church.
I want to thank the Lord for.
Amen. you said rheumatoid arthritis?
Yeah.
Like to have my Aunt Rhonda, well, both my Aunt Rhonda and Nokomis, and that Lord will have his way in their lives. Any unspoken requests?
Amen.
Emery, would you lead us in prayer? As we go.
Heavenly Father, we just thank you, God, for this time that you have given us tonight, God, as we come into the house to worship. And Father, we just pray now, Lord, that your Spirit would just lead and guide our hearts tonight, God, in the form of worship. That, Heavenly Father, we can worship thee tonight in spirit and in truth, God. And Father, in a way that be pleasing in thy sight. Father, we just pray, God, that you just bless every word that's going to be spoken, every song that's going to be sung tonight, God. And we just ask your special anointing and blessing upon your word as Brother Tony comes to break the bread of life. We ask you to strengthen him. Heavenly Father, give him the words to say, God, that, Father, that will discipline our hearts and touch us, Lord, and give us strength and the courage that we need next week. And Father, we just pray that you bless every request that have been spoken. Father, we know that you know the needs of every heart that is here, even if they're not spoken, God. And Father, we just ask, Lord, that you just satisfy our needs tonight. Minister to us through your word. And Father, let it go out with power and great glory, and we'll just worship thee together tonight. And Father, we just pray that you bless our pastor while he's away. Bless those that are going to be traveling, God. Give them traveling mercy and help them to return safely back to us, God, so that we can worship in this place together. And Father, we just ask all of these things. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
This week, Marv and Edna Fay are leaving, and just pray real hard that they'll get real homesick in about 3 days and decide they just can't do this and have to come home to the cold and the things that we'll be experiencing. They'll feel sorry for us, just want to be a part of us and come back. Now pray they'll enjoy themselves. I asked Ray to sing this song, and Ray does know a lot of songs, but this is just, I just sometimes have to hear this song. When the world seems cold and things just don't seem right, you know, yeah, we all have friends, but there's still some times when we're all alone, even with friends. And as a child of God, even when we don't feel like it, we do have someone that cares. Someone that, no matter what the circumstances may be, have you ever had that experience where it's, God, where are you? But he's there.
Amen.
And he does care.
When the world seems cold and your friends seem few, there is someone who cares for you. When tears in your eyes, your heart bleeds inside, there is someone who cares for you. blue. There is someone who cares for you. When you need a friend till the end, there is someone who's a friend to you.
Verse one more time. And you know, I was just a kid when this song was written, and I remember as a young kid I loved this song. I loved Jimmy Davis. He was a great guy. Wasn't always a great guy. He was a really bad guy at one time, but God got a hold of him and became a wonderful man, a wonderful mentor to so many people. It didn't have to be. He was well off. And I just remember as a child just liking how the song felt. Now, musicians are kind of that way. A lot of times I don't pay attention to words. I don't even pay attention to songs that are sung. I even listen to voices as instruments more than I do as singing words. But as I got older and I thought about these words, I thought, how true. How could someone just have that come to them? Where did these thoughts come from that are so poetic and paint pictures with words? Listen to that last verse again.
When your disappointments come and you feel so blue, there is someone who cares for you. When you need a friend to the end, there is someone who's a friend to you.
Sing it, guys.
Someone to care, someone to share all your troubles like no other can do.
He'll come down from the sky.
He'll come down from the sky and brush the tears from your eyes. You're his child, and he cares for you.
Amen. Do you know what key you do? Do you know what key he does it in?
I think it's G.
G.
I haven't tried this in a while. You guys help me. In the dark of the midnight, have I all hid my face while a storm howls above me? And there's no hiding place in the crash of the thunder.
precious Lord, hear my cry, keep me safe till the storm passes by. Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. Hold me fast, let me stand in the hollow of thy hand. Keep me safe till the storm passes by. Many times Satan tells me there's no need to try, for there's no end of sorrow, no more hope by and by. But I know thou art with me, and tomorrow I'll rise where the storm never darkens the sky. Till the storm passes over, till the thunder sounds no more, till the clouds roll forever from the sky. Hold me fast, let me stand in the hollow of thy hand. Keep me safe till the storm passes by.
You could have continued if you wanted to. I enjoyed that. Aren't you glad that you have a God that is able to meet every need that you have? There's no problem too great, no storm so strong that you can't feel His presence and feel the comfort that only He can give. We have a home down south, and we remodeled it, and it's a block house. It's got 8 inches of block, then it's got 2x4s and drywall, and then I put some siding on top of that. And when the electrical company came out to inspect the electrical part of the house, he said, "How come these walls are so thick?" And they're about 13.5 inches. And I told him what all it consists of. He said, "I don't know you real personally, but if I'm in the area when a storm comes, I'm going to be your neighbor because I'm going to be here." He said, "That house will withstand the storm." Well, I'm thankful that I've got a God that can withstand the storm, and He can strengthen each and every one of us to where that we can endure it. And not only endure, but we can come out on the other side victorious. Because everything that we endure down here, if we endure them in the manner that God wants us to, that He'll receive honor and glory some way or other. We're thankful tonight for you that have come to be with us, and hopefully that something will be said or done, that you'll go home and say it was worth the trip. Brother Larry, next few weeks, is going to be traveling, and so we're kind of stuck with me, but we'll do the best that we can. You remember us in prayer for strength, and help us to where that we might be able to minister unto you while He has gone out of town. In the Bible, it compares a Christian life to a race. Paul mentions it in his writings a couple of times, that this walk of life that we live is compared to a race. I never did do much running. Tom, do you still run? Do you still run? I know JC, you running any, JC? JC ran some marathons back, maybe when he was a little younger, and he told me a couple of experiences that he had while he was at the marathon, either during it or after, and I didn't think that t-shirt was worth that much, and I thought I'd just buy mine rather than have to endure all the things that he happened to him along the way. But if you have your Bibles tonight and turn with us to the 12th chapter of the book of Hebrews, starting with verse 1, Hebrews chapter 12, verse 1. We'll stand for the reading of God's word. Wherefore, seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witness, let us lay aside every weight and let the sin which do so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking into Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we're so thankful tonight for your blessings. Father, most of all, we're thankful that we know that we have that blessed assurance that we're a child of yours, that we've had the blood applied to our lives, and Father, we're so thankful for that, that it keeps us safe in the storms of life. We may have to go through the storms that so many times that we as your children begin to cry wolf before you ever is at the door. But we read in your precious word where the Hebrew children had to endure the flames. They had to go into the fire. We see Daniel had to go into the lion's den. But you kept them safe, and to where that people could realize that their God, the God of Israel and the God of us today, is the true and living God. Father, help us to where that we might look into your precious word. Give us the privilege, O God, of saying something that would be of help to someone. Help us to word that would never say anything within ourselves, but it would come from your precious word and through the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Paul talks about a race, and a race that is set before each of us. And the way that we run that race is determined how that we're equipped to. All runners long to win. When we start a contest, we have a desire to win, don't we? I had a friend that played 4 years of basketball in high school and never won a game. And his sister said that every Monday morning that he would be so down on Saturday because they lost. But she said by Monday that he had revived and he'd start practicing again, and he was sure that they was going to win the next game. He endured, although that he never was on a winning team, but he enjoyed the game, and every game, I believe, that he entered in, we can win this one. I had a coach when I was in high school that you could be down at halftime, 20 points, and he had a way of motivating you that you came out and you thought you could win the game, that you could make a comeback. And I was only about 5'6 at that time, weighed about 125 pounds, and I would come out thinking, I can dunk that ball. Well, it wasn't. I couldn't. But he gave you that encouragement. He gave you that that you could, that it was possible, that just put forth the effort. And that's the same way as you and I as a child of God. We look around us and we talk about the storms and we talk about all the things that we are experiencing in this walk of life. We look around us and we see the turmoil in the world today. But I'm thankful that I have the Word of God that encourages me and equips me to where that I realize that I'm a winner. Not because of me or not because of anything that I will do. It's because that I met a man named Jesus when I was 9 years old. And he told me, he said, I'll never leave you or forsake you. I'll go with you all the way. And so he equipped me to live a Christian life. He not only came in and saved my soul, but he gave me the Holy Spirit to where that it would help me in my everyday walk of life. That when I read the Word of God, that the Holy Spirit would open up my understanding to where that I might have a better understanding of the Word of God. I believe, according to what I can read and from what I understand, the Bible was written by men as the Holy Spirit inspired them. And I believe that if you're going to understand the Word of God, that you'll have to have the Holy Spirit to open up His Word to where that you might grow in grace and knowledge of the Lord. I believe if you're a lost person, the only thing that you can understand about the Word of God is that you're lost and in need of a Savior. And today that seems like that's not very popular with people today, that they want to be able to live any way that they want to and still go to heaven. But that wasn't the plan that God had established before the foundation of the world. He had a plan before He spoke this place into existence. Before you and I were born, that He had a plan for each and every one of us. And that He was going to equip us to the best that we could be to where that He could use us for His honor and His glory. What do we need to run to win in this race that we're running today? I believe that we need discipline. According to Paul in 1 Corinthians 9, 24 through 27, we need discipline in our lives. Some of you are teachers, and we can see today that one of the things that is missing today in our schools is discipline. No, you're no longer able to correct them with any substance. And we see that even in our homes that we cannot correct our children because that they have heard Oprah and we've heard all these other programs on TV that tells the children what to do, exactly what to do. If they get mad at you, they can call the police and you're in trouble. You know, it's almost impossible to defend yourself. So I believe that you and I, as a child of God, that we need discipline in our lives, that and that God chastises us if you're a child of God. We need discipline in devotional life. Today, then I believe that we need to read the Word of God more than we've ever done it before because that we need it today because of the things that's coming against our church and our nation as a whole. I believe that we need to know, thus saith the Lord. Not what this one's opinion is or that one's opinion, but what God's Word says, because it's more than opinion. Each one of us have an opinion, but there's only one Word of God. And if my opinion does not line up with the Word of God, I'm wrong and God's right. And that's the same way with anybody. And so that we need devotion in our life, and we need to realize, what do we think? What do we think about? What is our mindset? What's our thoughts? And what are we thinking from day to day? I had a pastor that told me one time that he says, you cannot stop some thoughts coming into your mind. The best that you can do, you'll have an evil thought that comes in your mind. But he said, it's like the birds of the air. You don't have to let the bird build a nest there. Now, in other words, you don't have to dwell upon those thoughts. Get rid of them, ask God's forgiveness, and go on. And it'll take discipline. It'll take devotion to do that. Yeah, commitment to God. God, I want your way more than anything else in the Word of in this world. One of the greatest statements that Christ made, not my will, but thine be done. He said, I came into the world to do the work of the Father. He didn't come to do anything else but to share his Father, to show us the Father, to where that we might realize who he was. And so that we need to have discipline in what we think. We need to have discipline in how that we talk today. That it behooves me that you can't hardly go out to have a meal without someone using such language that it would make a sailor blush 20 years ago. And it is upsetting to me for my wife and my grandkids and my kids to hear that, because they've never been exposed to that. Not that I know of, at least. But yet, that is common today. But our talk that they should distinguish us from the world because of that language that we use is not profane, but it's something that is of encouragement and to help someone and to tell somebody the good news of Jesus Christ. And so that we need to pay attention, have discipline in our what we talk and what we do. Our actions, we can talk a good game, but does our actions back it up? If Brenda got up every morning and told me that she loved me, but showed no effort in doing anything to express that love, pretty soon it would become just words, and it would be meaninglessly. But when she not only tells me that she loves me, she shows me because of her actions and her deeds. And that's the same way as you and I, that as children of God, that we can not only just tell somebody the good news of the gospel, but to where that we might express it in our actions towards them and doing good deeds. And so that we can see discipline in our morals today, that it seems our morality is on a decline. It seemed like anything goes. Things that was sacred when I was a kid growing up, and even 20 years ago when my children were growing up, today it is looked upon as just acceptable in society. Well, the society may be willing to accept it, but God is not, because what was sin and in the sight of God 30 years ago is still sin today. And we need to realize that he's the same yesterday, today, and forever, that he changes not. And if we're going to be a child and we're going to of God and we're going to be effective, we've got to have that consistency in our lives. I believe that people are looking for something that is consistent, something that they can depend on day in and day out. And I believe that you and I have that message as a child of God. We have that capacity to show them, I'm content in my relationship with Christ. I'm content with who I am. Not that I'm content with the condition that the world is in. I may not be content in the way that people are living their life, but I'm content because of my relationship with Jesus Christ. I wish everyone had a relationship. We must achieve self-control today, that it seems like there's no self-control, just anything, to where that people do whatever. If it feels good, do it, and regardless if it don't hurt anybody. They talk about victimless crimes. I believe that any time that you break the word of God, the laws of God, there's a victim involved somewhere along the way. The influence that you may have, or the impression that you might make upon that person, to where that they view Christianity as just a fable or something that people seek after when they get old. Or sometimes people say Christianity is a crutch. I need a crutch. I'm crippled. I'm a sinner. And the only difference between me is I've been saved by the grace of God. I need that crutch. I need Jesus Christ in my life to help me along the way. I need the Holy Spirit in my life to help me to avoid the temptations that come to temper in all things. I'm not tempted as I was today, that I was the same as I was 30, 40 years ago. But you never get too old to where the devil is not always trying to tempt you and to lead you away from God, to where that someone can see you fail, to where that they can say there's nothing to Christianity.
This comes from the Holy Spirit. I'm thankful that I don't have to, if I wasn't big enough to keep my, to save myself, I'm not big enough to keep myself. And therefore, I have to depend upon the Holy Spirit each day. When I arise each and every day, I have to make a choice of whether I'm going to live for the Lord and be a child of God, or whether I'm going to get up and do whatever I want to do and at the end of the day have regrets. See, I've never regretted one thing that I've ever done for the glory of God. A lot of people have a lot of regrets, and I hear some people say, I regret not being saved when at an earlier age, when they have been saved in their 40s and 50s, maybe even their 60s, they say, I regret living my life. I wish I had come to know Christ at an early age, to where that I might have done more for him in this walk of life. This comes from the Holy Spirit. I'm thankful that when he saved me, he gave me the Holy Spirit to help me along the way. We must be led by the Spirit and not by the flesh. This coming year, Tony Massengill, I will not be very happy because this old flesh on the outside sees it with the eye and he wants it. If it flashes, Brenda says that I'm like a crow. If it's shiny, I want it. And so that we see that when I see something, this natural man wants it. I don't need it. I probably not even have no use for it. But because of the temptation, because of the brightness, because of the things that I can see that it might accomplish in my life. But yet I realize that's the flesh, and the flesh will never be satisfied. This fleshly man will never be satisfied. If you're dependent upon happiness upon the flesh, you'll be a miserable person this year. Because that you'll never get out of a want. You'll never be out of that place to where you're attracted to the brightness and the things of the world, because there's pleasure in sin. I would be the biggest liar in Monroe County if I told you there was not pleasure in sin. There is. But it's only for a season. It's only for a short period of time. And I see so many people only living for the moment. A lot of our children and grandchildren are just living for the moment. If it feels good today, go ahead and do it and suffer the consequences tomorrow. But I'm thankful that we need to be led by the Holy Spirit and not by the flesh, because with this inward man, or this man, this spiritual man, this child of God, Tony Massengill, I'll be happy this. He'll be joyful this year because the joy comes from the Lord. It does not come from happenings. It doesn't come from circumstances. It comes from having a right relationship with God. And I promise you, you'll have joy unspeakable, because no one can take that away from you. If you're dependent upon if your happiness is dependent upon somebody or something, you'll come away disappointed. But when you put your confidence and your faith in Christ Jesus, I've never heard one say, I'm disappointed. I'm disappointed in the things of God. I'm disappointed in how that God did this. I may not enjoy it at the time, but at the end of the road, it'll be beneficial. And so that we can see, we need directions. We can never win the race by looking back. You have to keep your eyes. What did Paul say? Keeping your eyes upon who? Jesus Christ, the author and the finisher of our faith, but keeping our eyes upon him to where that he can give us the directions through his word and through the Holy Spirit, and we've got purpose in life. We're accomplished something that is worthwhile, not just temporary, but those things that we accomplish for the glory of God is eternal. When we lead someone to Christ, then I believe that's the closest thing that you can come to being saved again. I don't, that once saved, I always say, don't get me wrong, but when you see a person come to Christ, you know what they experience. You know what they are feeling. They know that the burden of sin has been lifted. The shackles of sin has been lifted from them, and they're free in Christ Jesus. And so that we cannot win the race by looking backward. We can draw strength from it, but we cannot win the race by looking backward. Forgetting those things which are behind, Paul said, forgetting about the past and leave it behind. Forgetting those old wounds and those old wrongs and those things that transpired in her life. Holding grudges in her life doesn't help anybody. It doesn't help you because a lot of times you're miserable and the person that you have a grudge against don't even know what they've done to you. And so we hold on to those. I ain't giving it up. I enjoy being miserable. Well, just keep holding on to them then. And I promise you'll be miserable. But if you'll get rid of those things, forgive those people that have wronged you. Forget, bind up those old wounds. Yes, there'll be a scar there. But a scar is far better than a wound. My scar don't bother me much. The wound did. And so that we can see. Reaching forth into those things which are before. I've got a past with the devil. Did you ever notice that? The devil's always bringing something up in the past. He's always trying to get you to go back there, and he says, look at what you did then. Look how miserable. Look what you did. You're not a fit to be a child of God. God never does that. He never brings past. When we get forgiveness, he casts that sin into a sea of forgiveness, never to be remembered again. It's the devil that brings up those old things and tries to hinder us from looking forward unto Jesus Christ because he realizes that if you're in Christ Jesus, you've got a future. You've got a future to die. And that's what we need to pay attention to, not allowing the devil to bring up those things in the past to where that we might dwell upon those rather than looking forward to what God's going to do in 2016. 2015 has been a kind of a terrible year. My health has not been the best, but I'm looking forward to 2016 because I still have a hope in Christ Jesus. I'm still on this side of glory, and there's still something that I can do to help someone to where that they might come to know Christ Jesus. Seizing the opportunity to serve Christ. Seizing it eagerly. Not begrudgingly, not saying, well, if I don't do it, nobody else will. If I don't do it, blah, blah, blah. Do it because that God wants you to. That should be motivation enough. Do it because that it'll bring honor and glory to the Lord and to where that you might be able to find your place in serving him in the capacity that he sees fit. Eagerly welcome those spiritual challenges that come before. Sometimes I hear people say, I've never taught Sunday school or I've never taught a class. And I'm not telling you that that's what God wants out of you, but I'm telling you something, that there's some spiritual challenges that we need to step up to where that we can grow in our spiritual life to where that people, that you'll be happy and the people around you will receive a blessing. Pressing toward the mark. Pressing towards that mark. Making best use of the time for service. So many times today that I find myself so busy, but at the end of the day I accomplish very little. Sometimes when you retire, and there's a lot of us that's retired, it don't seem like we get nothing as much accomplished now that we've got all the time in the world than we did when we were working, but we used our time better. So when we get up in the morning, I don't think I'm going to cut the grass today. I can do it later on this afternoon. But if you're working, you have to plan that. You know, if you don't get it done the next day, you got to go into work, blah, blah, blah. But what I'm saying is seizing the time. And using it effectively for the glory of God. And to her that the making the best use of our time for service. Always living for the glory of God. Not living for myself, not living for the moment, but living to bring honor and glory to the Lord. Those around us, to where that we can see that when Moses came down after out of the mountain after communing with God, that he shined so brightly, they had to put a veil across his face. I wish every one of us would go out of this place and our faces would radiate to the point of where that people could see that we have been with Jesus, that we've been with the Master. We have worshiped him in spirit and in truth, and it's made a difference in my life because I want to go out and tell somebody. I want to go out and do something for somebody to where that I can tell them the good news of the gospel. Always expecting the Lord's return. Today that we don't hear, I'm look, I, I, sometimes I get excited to think about one of these days the Lord's going to return and I'm going to get to go, that I can leave all of these problems in this world has, and I can go and be in the presence of the great I Am, and I can be in the presence of His saints and those that have been saved by His grace, and we'll be rejoicing and shouting the praises of God because of the God and what He has done for us. But always looking for Him, always expecting Him to come, because if we're expecting Him to come, we'll live our lives in a manner to where that people can see the difference. Living with eternal rewards in mind. What I accomplish with a dollar amount will not be worth very much. But if you lead someone to cross, those are eternal rewards. Those are people that don't have to worry when life comes to an end, that they've got a better place to go to. Those are eternal things. And to her that we would keep our mind upon those. We need to be dressed for the race. As I've read, laying aside every weight. A runner dresses lightly. He doesn't carry any extra weight. To her that he wants to have every advantage that he possibly can, to where that he can run that race at the best that he can. And if I win it, I know I'm capable of it. And if I win it, glory to God. If not, I've ran the race. I put forth the effort. I've done my best. And see, I don't see anywhere where God says, well, look at all your accomplishment. He said, well done, thy good and faithful servant. He doesn't say what that servant has done, does he? He doesn't say, well, you went to church all the time and you preached or you taught or you sang. Well done, my good and faithful servant. That's all he wants out of us is our service, because he's the end result. I can't do but very little in my own that's worthwhile. But I can do, when God uses us, that which we accomplish, I'll be eternal. And so that they dress lightly. Get all those weights of baggage that we have, that we carry from time to time. We laugh. A number of years ago, Brenda was into health, exercise drastically. We were going on vacation. Larry and Vicky was with us. I just had the back surgery. And Larry says, I'll carry the luggage. I said, that's great. He got Brenda's suitcases and she had her weights in it. He picked that suitcase and his feet almost flew out off and under him, because she had weighted it down. She was wanting to exercise, even though that we were on vacation, that she brought those weights. Maybe she thought they didn't have them there, or they were different there, or whatever. But that weight, I can still remember the expression on Larry's face. You know, what do you have in there? But see, we bring baggage with us. I tell Brenda, no matter whether we go south in a Volkswagen or a semi, it's full. I've got enough clothes. It don't matter. I don't use half of them. But if I needed them, I got them. But see, we leveled ourselves down with so much baggage. That's comical, and I say that in the comical mood. Larry's over his hernia. But we say that, but we load ourselves down so much with that stuff, and it becomes just more baggage. And we get used to carrying it, and pretty soon we don't even realize we've got it. Until we get rid of it, and you think, oh my goodness, why didn't I do that a long, long time ago? They dress lightly. They dress to be the best and efficient that we can. What weights have we been hindering? Your progress in this race. Are you weighted down with the cares of the world? Are you just so anxious and so upset because a condition or something that's transpiring,
and you think it's out of control? Let me assure you, God's still on the throne, and he's still in control. It don't matter how chaotic we may think we are, and the places that we're at, no matter how chaotic it may seem, God's still on the throne. And if you're one of his, what did Ray sing about? He cares for me. He cares and wants the very best for me. Those weighted down with the cares of this life. Unforgiveness. For not forgiving those that you think or have wronged you. Making it right. Having a negative attitude. I read an article, and I've always thought about this in the churches that I've pastored. Sometimes when we make change, and somebody say, we never done it that way before. Well, maybe we need to. Maybe we need to make some changes. Maybe we need to have some. What I'm saying is, don't have a negative attitude. Two guys worked together for a number of years. And he came over one time and he told me, he said, Tony, he said, I can come in here on a Monday morning. The sun can be shining. The birds chirping. And it's a beautiful day. And I can go over there and work with that guy for 2 hours. And I want to go home and go pow, pow, pow. Because he says, nothing is right. And he says, I listen to it and pretty soon I'm in the same boat as he is because I'm allowing his negative attitude to influence my thinking and my actions. And so that we see that having a negative attitude. See, it's as easy to be positive as it is to be negative. Fears in this walk of life. Fears about whether or not are we going to have enough money. Fears about our children and our grandchildren, what's going to happen to them. Fear is opposite of faith. Every morning when I get up and my feet hit the floor, I say, God, they're in your hands. I can't protect them. I can't go with them to school and I can't go with them to work, but you can. God, I can't control the circumstances that they may have to face, but you can. I'm putting them in your hands, Lord, because I realize that I'm limited, but you're limitless. You can do all things. Because, see, when I begin to dwell upon the negative, it drains my energy. It takes zaps my energy. And Lord knows that some of us need all the energy that we can get. We're not that little bunny running around. We need to have our strength. We need to have our energy to where we can apply it in the right way. How are you doing in this race? Let me bring it down to you. How are you doing? Rewards for the winners will make every effort worthwhile. The rewards for the winners will make every effort worthwhile. It will be worth it all when we see Jesus. I don't know what all I may have to endure. I know, yeah, I worry about it sometimes. Sometimes I'm like everybody else. I'm no different than anybody else. I worry. But at the end of the road, I'm going to see Jesus. I'm going to be in his presence just because he loved me. Not because of who I was or what I did or whatever adelaide that you want to put to it. He done it simply because he loved me and desired to have a relationship with a little 9-year-old boy. And that relationship as I said this morning, is getting sweeter and sweeter as the days go by, because I'm closer home than I was yesterday. I'm closer home now than I was in 2015. And I don't know what the future holds, but I know the one that holds the future. And let's trust him. Individually, to where we'll be effective in our homes with our children and our grandchildren. Because ever how effective we are in our homes is pretty much how effective we are when we come to church. If you want to be effective, it first has to start with you. And today that we see the great need. How many here, and I don't want to see your hand, how many here has got lost loved ones? Just let your mind just think for just a split second. Every one of us, no doubt, have got loved ones that we'd love to see come to know Christ. That should be enough to encourage us and to help us to where that God, I know that you're able. And I'm going to do everything I can. See, a lot of times we think, well, that individual still has to come to that knowledge. But if he's got a lot of influence around him, it's a whole lot easier to make that choice. I pray that God will help us and use us this coming year. As I said, just pray for us. This past year, we feel that we've let Brother Larry down in the church. Our health hasn't been that great. But if God will help me, I enjoy. There's a lot better preachers, and you deserve a lot better. But I tell you what, you don't have anybody that enjoys it any more than I do to try to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we're so thankful to be your child, that you loved us. That you loved us, you continue to love us. And Lord, when we get there to that place that you prepared, maybe we can show you that more perfect love that you bestowed upon us in this walk of life. Help our church to grow and prosper. Help us to reach the lost. Help us to meet every need that is here by your might, by your strength, and by your word. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, that's 7. I won't get scolded by letting you out early tonight. But I pray you have a good week. God bless you.